Hey, this is Jake Bartlett for School of Motion, and I am super excited to be walking you through Superstroker, which is a tool that I made for After Effects that can take really complex animations and make them extremely easy to make. You can download this tool for free as a preset through School of Motion right on this page. All you need is a free School of Motion student account, and then you'll be able to download this preset, as well as get access to tons of other great stuff on School of Motion. So once you've logged into your student account and downloaded the preset, you'll need to install it. So let's jump right in. I have my preset right here on the desktop, so I'm just going to select it and copy, and then I'm going to come into my animation presets inside of After Effects and select any existing preset in this list, come to this menu right here and go down to Reveal in Finder, and that will open up the presets folder for the version of After Effects you have open, and then right here in the presets root I will paste, and there we have Superstroker. Then I'll come back to After Effects, go to that same menu and go down to the very bottom where it says Refresh List. After Effects will refresh all of my presets. And then if I come back into my animation presets, there it is, Superstroker, and we're good to go. All you have to do to use it is make sure you don't have any layer selected, and then double click. After Effects will generate that shape layer with all of the Superstroker controls applied, and you're ready to go. First, I'll just show you how quickly I can make a pretty complex animation. So I'll go forward to maybe 1 second, open up my trim paths control under Superstroker, and these are the exact same controls that you would have if you had applied trim paths to a regular shape layer. So I'll just set a keyframe on the end value, go back to the beginning, and drop that down to 0. Then I'll press U to bring up my keyframes, easy ease them, go into my graph editor and adjust the curves just a little bit, and then preview. All right, so there's already a lot happening. First thing I want to do is adjust my color. So I already have my color palette set up over here on a shape layer. All I have to do is come over to my color pickers and adjust them. So I'll just grab all the colors that I've already made in my palette. And I'll play that back again. And now my colors are updated. But let's say I don't want it to end on this pink color. Well, all I have to do is rearrange these colors. And the order automatically updates. So now instead of ending on pink, it ends on yellow. So the order of these colors determine what order the colors of the Superstroker layer appear in. So very quickly I was able to rearrange that color palette. All right, let's take a look at some other things that we can do. Down here we have some delay controls. And all I have animated right now is the end value, so we're gonna look at the delay end. All the delay values are measured in frames, and this is how you control the offset for each one of the duplicates. Right now, each one is offset by 2 frames. So if I come to the beginning and I go 1, 2, the first 2 frames are just white. Then we've got 1, 2 frames of pink, 1, 2 frames of green, and so on. If I increase this to say 5, now these are gonna be more spread out. There's 5 frames between each one of them. I'll play that back. You see we have a more gradual animation now. The cool thing about this value is that you can keyframe it. So let's say that I want it to start out at 5 frames delay, but then by the time it reaches the end, I only want it to be set to 1. So I'll bring up my keyframes and set the delay down to 1, easy ease those, and then preview again. Now you see that at the start, it's very spread out, 5 frames at a time, but by the time it gets to the end, they're all much closer together. Then let's say I want it to animate out, all I have to do is go to where the animation is finished, and that is important. You need to make sure that all of your colors have finished animating, and then go to the start value, add a keyframe, go forward in time a little bit, set that to 100%. Again, I'll adjust the value curve just to make it a little more dynamic. And play that back. And again, we have delay controls for the start value. This is set to 2, but I could adjust this to say 4. And it will very quickly update for me. And just like that, we have a pretty complex animation that without Superstroker would take a lot more layers and a whole lot more keyframes. But Superstroker is great for a lot more than just circles. So let's take a look at a more complex example. I have some paths here that I've already created, and this is not a font. This is just something that I drew by hand using the pen tool. And I want to copy all of these paths into my Superstroker layer. To quickly do that, I'll just switch to the pen tool, select one point, then hold down Command to make a selection around all of the paths. Copy, and I'll turn off this layer and go into the contents of this Superstroker layer and then into the paths folder. And you see that I put some notes. This is where you want to put your custom paths. I'll go in there and delete the circle that's already there, then select that group and paste. And only part of my paths are being styled right now because there's one more thing I need to do. I'll close up my paths and go into my strokes group. And right now there are four color groups. And we'll get into how to handle these groups in just a little bit. For now, I want to delete all but the first color group, open that up, and there's a whole bunch of stuff in this folder, but all you need to worry about is what's right up here at the top. There's a group named Path 1. I need the same number of paths in here as I have in my Master Paths group. So there's 8 different paths, so I need to duplicate this until I have 8. And as I do that, you can see that all of my paths are now being styled. Then I'll collapse that folder and reduplicate it until I have 4 colors again. Awesome, now my paths are on the superstructure layer. I'll get rid of my old layer. And I still have the same keyframes from before, so let's just preview and see what it looks like. Now obviously this animation is a little fast, and the reason it looks so fast is because there's a lot more paths to be trimmed in that span of time. So I could just stretch this out a little bit. And preview that again. And there we go, another very complex animation being driven by a single layer. Now another great feature of superstructure is this delay paths property. Even though I have 8 separate paths on this layer, they're being trimmed as if it was just one long continuous path. But if I change my trim multiple paths from sequentially to simultaneously, and then speed up my animation just a little bit, I'll preview one more time. Now all of my paths are being trimmed at the same time. But if I come down to the delay paths value and increase this to say 5, I'm just gonna move my start keyframes out of the way for now. And I'll get rid of the animation on delay end and set that to say 3. Because I increase the delay paths value, each path is going to be trimmed as if it was its own layer, offset by the number of frames that you set this property to. So in this case, 5 frames. So the first part of the rectangle animates, then 5 frames goes by, the next one starts, all the way through the order of my paths. But let's say I wanted the numbers to animate first and the frame last. All you have to do is go into your contents, into your master paths group, and then rearrange the paths. So these first 4 paths are the rectangle. I'll just select those and drag them down to the bottom. Now the numbers will animate on first, followed by the frame. Then I'll bring my start keyframes back. Again, I need to make sure that the entire animation is completed before those start keyframes. Then we'll play this back. And I have an extremely complex animation, all being animated on a single shape layer with just 4 keyframes. And that is really powerful. Without superstructure, this animation would take at least 4 layers, one for every color, times the number of paths, which is 8, so I would need 32 layers plus a whole lot more keyframes. And let's say you wanted to add another color. That would be really complex without superstructure, but all I have to do is duplicate one of my color effects, change the color to whatever I want, so let's say orange, then go back into my contents, into my strokes group, and then duplicate one of these color groups. Superstructure automatically generates another stroke based on the color that you set in your effects controls. All you need to do is make sure that you have the same number of color groups as you do color effects. And that easily, you're able to update the look of your animation. I'm just gonna take that last color out, and then let's take a look at some of the other controls. After trim paths, we have the stroke style with the stroke width. And this is where you can control the global width of all of your strokes. And I say global because I could drop this down to say 10, but then I'll go into my contents and select any one of my colors. So let's say the second one, and I'll back this up to where we can see all of our colors. And then with color 2 selected, I'll come up to the pixel value of that stroke and increase it. As I do that, you see that I'm adjusting the width of just that color. So the global width is 10, but then you can add width to any one of these strokes individually. So let's say I want the last one to be 50. Well, I've got the global width of 10, I'll add 40 to that, and now my last stroke is 50. If I play that back, now I've got a totally different look. And to quickly get back to a uniform stroke width, I'll just select the layer, go up to the pixel width and set it to 0, and then I'm back to controlling it all with just that stroke width. We've also got controls for the stroke opacity, which adjusts everything at once. And then we've got another very powerful little shortcut here, which is caps and joins. If I open up this list, I have access to every combination of cap and join. So if I wanted round caps and round joins, I just select that. Now I have round caps and round joins. Let's say that I wanted to keep the flat caps. I'll set this to butt and round. And this is just an easy way to quickly adjust the look of my stroke without having to go digging through the shape layer. For now, I'm just going to set that to round on both cap and joins. Then next up, we have operators. Here you have easy access to a handful of shape layer operators. I'll set the stroke width down to say 15 and then enable the repeater. So I'll just open it up, click on the enable repeater checkbox, set the copies to maybe 10. Then I'll open up the transform for that repeater, and all of these controls should look very familiar because they're exactly the same as if you had added an operator into the shape layer. And I'll change the scale X and Y down to say 90. And then I'll turn the end opacity down to 0. And then maybe I'll adjust the position down a little bit. And then just for fun, I'll increase the rotation to say 5 degrees. And we've got a very crazy looking animation very quickly. I really like playing around with operators, and I think that you can get some very unique looking stuff just from messing around with them. So hopefully having access to a handful of these can help you play around with some cool looking animations. Now, if there's an operator that you want to use and it's not in this list, that's not a problem. You can absolutely add your own. Just come down to the contents of your shape layer, go to add and say offset paths, and this will behave just like normal. So let me increase the offset a little bit, turn it to a round join. And again, we've created something completely unique. But you can use superstructure in other ways than just on custom drawn paths. Let me show you a couple more examples. Here's a write-on animation using an actual text layer. So if I turn off superstructure, you see that this is a normal text layer, but I laid it out and then I traced paths on top of it so that they would reveal that text when I set it to an alpha mat. So these are the paths that I traced on top of this text, and you'll notice that I line them up right on the center of each one of the shapes of every letter. Once I had all the letters traced, I copied and pasted the paths to a superstroker layer, just like we did with the first example. Then I put it underneath the text, set it to an alpha mat, so that nothing outside of that text layer would be visible, and then I just increased the stroke width until it filled the entire text. So if this were any lower, you wouldn't see all of the text because it's going beyond the stroke width of the superstroker layer. But once it fills the entire text, I set up the trim paths to trim multiple shapes sequentially, added a 5-frame delay, and I also keyframed the delay end so that it starts out more spaced out and ends up very close together. And that's how you can use superstroker to do a write-on. But you can also reveal text in other ways that don't require tracing. Here I have another text layer, just a long line of text that would be a lot of tracing if I were to do a write-on, but that would also take a lot of time to animate on. If you need longer lines of text to animate on more quickly, you can still use that text as a mat, but then make your original path much simpler. So if I turn off the track mat, you see that this is just a single line going directly across the screen, and I angled it to match the italics of the text just by going into the contents, into my paths, into the transform controls, and you'll notice that I added a skew to my paths group. So now when it animates, those lines aren't perfectly up and down, they're at a slant. Then when I set that to an alpha mat, all that I see is the text. And I've got a very cool multicolored wipe that's super easy to animate and customize. Superstroker can be used with more than just text though. You can use a graphic. And this is set up exactly the same way. Instead of a text layer, I have an Illustrator file. And my superstroker layer is just a circle with a really wide stroke that creates this kind of radial wipe. When I set that to be an alpha mat, I've got this multicolored radial reveal. Super simple to set up, but it can produce some pretty cool looking animations. And that is superstroker. This tool was a lot of fun for me to make, and I'm really excited to see what you can do with it. I hope that you get a lot of use out of it, and if you do use it in any of your work, be sure to share that on social media and tweet us at School of Motion so that we can see it. Be sure that you're signed up for that free School of Motion student account so that you can download this tool and get access to all of the project files for all of the lessons that are on School of Motion, plus a whole bunch of other great stuff. And if you liked Superstroker, please share it on social media. It really helps us get the word out about School of Motion, and we greatly appreciate it. Thanks again so much for watching this video, and I'll see you next time.